Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's feeling wonderful on this Memorial Day as we remember those who gave their lives so we could be here today. How wonderful. I want to read one verse from Romans chapter 13, verse 7. Render therefore to all their dues, tributes to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom is due, fear to whom fear is due, honor to whom honor is due. And that's what today is all about, is honor to those who gave their lives to keep our country clear. Let's open in prayer. Oh, gracious Father, this Memorial Day, just help people remember what it is, that it's not a time to go out and party and have fun and an extra day off. It's to remember those from the beginning of this country to today who stood firm for the beliefs that you gave us from the beginning. You gave us freedom, Father, and they fought for that freedom, and many have died for that freedom. Many died to keep your word alive, Lord. Let us remember them and the families of the fallen, Father. Now I ask you to just bless us this day here as we honor you in song and worship. And the pastor has a message that you gave him for us for this day. Just be with us this whole day and through the week, Lord, that we remember you and remember what this is about, what this day is. Don't let us forget, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. If we can stand, please stand for our doxology and our worship to God in praise.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Just keep Him in your heart and praise Him every morning. Wake up, praise Him for a new day.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
And all hail the power of Jesus' name.
Hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown Him Lord of all.
Right.
crown him Lord of all. Build your kingdom here.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil what we've made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We see your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives for your joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor, the beast. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray revive this earth.
Yes, we need revival, Lord.
Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Set your church on fire. This nation
back.
Change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom.
Pray for our
land. Unleash your kingdom's power. Reach in the near and far. No force of hell can stop
your beauty.
Changing hearts. You aim for much more than this. Awake the kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength. Us up. This country needs to be waking up. Oh, how majestic is your name, Father. Oh, Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We praise your name.
Lord, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, we praise your name. O Lord, we magnify your name. Prince of peace, mighty God. God Almighty. O Lord, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. O Lord, we pray.
Peacefully as the deer. You, O Father, keep us in the Spirit. Pastor.
Good morning, family. It's great to see everybody here today, everybody who did come today. Please join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day that you've given us. May we remember what truly matters. And Lord, we just ask that as we look into your word, that you help us to understand what it is that we need to know, that we can be better people, that we can learn and grow in your image. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So as Brother Bill had alluded to earlier, this weekend, many people look forward to only because of the fact that it means a three-day weekend. Now, people rejoice in that. They say, great, we need a three-day weekend. We need a temporary reprieve Usually there's big picnics, special events are planned on this weekend, and of course, most every store has sales going on, if that's what you're into. For the most part, just like we see today, church attendance drops during the holiday season. It drops on weekends like this. And the reason for that is because people are either traveling to those events, they're spending time with families, they're partaking in the special sales that are going on. This actually, what we're doing is meant to remember those who gave their lives for this country. Sometimes people take that for granted. They take for granted that the freedoms that we enjoy in this nation were provided with the lives of brave men and women. If it had not been for them, we might not even be able to gather in church today. The Lord said in John, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, that he may lay down his life for his friends." Not everyone in the world has the privileges that we enjoy in this nation. Privileges that were afforded to us by these people. I want to read something to you that didn't come from a week ago. It didn't come from a month ago. It didn't come from a long time ago. It came from 4 days ago. And it illustrates the fact that days like today, when we observe what these men and women did and why it's so important. This is about North Korea. I don't know how many people are up on North Korea or what's going on in that nation, but that nation claims to be accepting of religious beliefs, yet their actions say something different. And this came from 4 days ago. It was printed, and it says, the State Department Office of International Religious Freedom, something I didn't even know that we had, citing research conducted by non-governmental agencies, so it's not biased by our agency, it's not skewed one way or another politically. And that's not why I'm reading this, because I have no political views when it comes to being up here at the pulpit. But it states, they have gathered testimony from defectors saying as many as 70,000, now let me repeat that, 70,000 Christians have been imprisoned in camps, along with those believers from other religions. Now that's to say that their nation does not take kindly to any religion, but if you can imagine 70,000 Christians being imprisoned. People who have been arrested for religious crimes have reportedly faced detention, forced labor, torture, sexual violence, and death. Christians are considered a hostile class and are regarded as the lowest in society and are consistently vulnerable and in danger. The Department of the State, pulling from the information they collected, noted that an entire family, including their 2-year-old child, was imprisoned following the discovery of their religious practices and their possession of a Bible. That oppression is not something that we're reading about in Jesus' time. That's not oppression that we find in the book of Revelations for the future. That is happening right now. There is some hope. I heard this morning, just on this matter, that there is a group, there is an organization that is compiling Bibles to send to North Korea. Their hopes is that they will be able to supply the Christians of North Korea with what they need to still be able to worship and read God's Word. So today, as we honor the men and women who've given everything for us, we should thank them for their service. But I want to pause for a moment in remembrance to those who did die in service to our country, our freedom, our security, and our beliefs. And as we remember those who gave all for our earthly freedoms, for our temporal freedoms, We must not forget and remember the ultimate price that was paid by Jesus Christ, the one who gave himself as an example for us to follow, who died for the forgiveness of our sins. Also, we can have the promise of eternal life. Last week, we covered that understanding one word can change what you believe the Bible to say. One word can change how you interpret what the Bible has to tell you. When I asked if you believe that you were justified, I told you that my goal was that in the end of the service, you would be able to say with a resounding yes, I am justified through the faith in Jesus Christ, the one who paid the price for my sins and died in my stead. And I hope that that actually was accomplished. Briefly, I spoke about being sanctified. The Bible tells us sanctification is God's will for us. Sanctification is a process of becoming more like Christ. And following the wisdom and the commandments contained in the Bible helps us to become sanctified. Through the Bible, sanctification is mentioned frequently as a call to align ourselves with God's will and to cleanse ourselves from sin. Today we'll be reading in the book of Romans, chapter 12. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 4, our text verse being verse 2. Now these verses have been read, and just like every Christian knows, if you read the Bible, it doesn't just say something to you once and that's it. There is more that you can learn from the same verses. So today when we look at these verses, regardless of what it is that you think you know about the verses, I want you to listen with an open heart to what's being read. So Romans chapter 12, where we'll be reading verses 1 through 4. Chapter 12, verse 1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. We've read those verses before. I want to go over some important parts that we just read. In verse 1, when it says, we are to present ourselves to the Lord as perfect sacrifices, what it's saying is, we are to stand before the Lord and say, I am yours, Lord. And in this case, we present ourselves to do his will, not ours. That is the sacrifice that we are making, is that we are putting away our wants, our needs, and saying, your will first, Lord. We yield ourselves to God for whatever he has planned for us. We submit to his will in our lives. And it is true that the body of the believer is the temple of the Holy Spirit. When you read 1 Corinthians, it says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. We are no way, shape, or form one in ourselves. We cannot claim our bodies as our own. If we are saved, we have given our bodies over. We have been crucified with Christ. We no longer live, but Christ lives within us. The body, in the context of the verse that we read, is totally, meaning whole, of our life. The activity of our life. The total person, not just the body. We are to give ourselves over physically, mentally, and spiritually to God, so that He can do what He sees right. By presenting ourselves to God, we become an active body for God's will. Meaning God's work is done through us by His will. In verse 2, our text says, "And be not conformed to this world." Now everybody thinks to themselves, that's a no-brainer there, Pastor. I know what that means. That means we're not supposed to be in the world. We're supposed to be in the world. People are naturally conformists. We know this. And we know that a lot of people don't like confrontation, so they go along to get along. They go with the crowd. God, however, asks us as believers to march to a different drummer, no matter what the cost is. We're not supposed to follow what the worldly are doing. When the Bible talks about not conforming or not being a part of the world, it's not saying that we are to totally separate ourselves from those who are not in Christ. We're supposed to separate ourselves from the non-believers because of the fact that the non-believers are not what we need to avoid. The world is not the people, but the temporal values and sinful nature that drives people in the world. It's the way the world is motivated. It's the way the people are motivated. Possessions, pride, pleasure, everything it is here and now. I want it now, so I'm going to get it now. I don't care about the future. That is worldly views. That is what we are to avoid, not the people. The people are who we are supposed to tell the good news to. The two areas that God wants us to be different, at least two that I can think of off the top of my head, is the way we think, because we are to think godly. You know those bumper stickers that everybody looks at and they kind of giggle, "What would Jesus do?" It used to be something that everybody had on the back of their cars. That is what we should be thinking. It's not a joke. We should be looking at the world and saying to ourselves, how would Jesus handle this situation? What would He do? Then we are supposed to act accordingly. We're not to say, oh, well, Jesus would turn the other cheek and He would show love, but I'm going to do the complete opposite. We are to do what God commands us to do. We are to follow the actions and the teachings of Jesus Christ. God wants our minds to be different than the ones that are in the world. We are to renew our minds. As we study and we learn, we can then obey God's word. We cannot obey something that we're not familiar with. There used to be people that would say, well, the ignorance of the law is no excuse. I believe that to be true when it comes to God's law, when it comes to God's will. Ignorance of God's will is no excuse for not living in God's will. We all have access to God's will, which means that we all should be following God's will. Now, the thing is that we're transformed by God's will when we work in the entirety of living in God's structure, how He tells us we should live. We cannot do this if we don't read the Bible. I know that some people think to themselves, man, he loves to harp on us about reading the Bible. And you're absolutely right, I do. Because that is a message that cannot be stressed enough. We are to read our Bibles because that is how we know who God is. That is how we know what God's will is. So I will continue to preach reading your Bible. Now we know that we are not able to fulfill God's will in our lives unless we do what is written in verse 1 and 2 that we read. We must present our bodies to the Lord so that He can use us as He sees fit. We must not be conformed to the world. We must not follow the ways of the world. And we must be transformed by using the Bible to renew our minds daily. Not just once a week, not just when you're here. We are supposed to do this daily. The will of God is not a mystery. It's not simply what we think must happen. And it's not something that we have to reveal by some kind of search. The Bible, this book right here, if you open it up to any page, you will be able to read God's will. You will be able to know God's will. This, I used to say, this is the owner's manual for human beings. This is the how-to. This is our guidebook, right? This is the book that tells the acceptable will of God. If you want to be in God's will, read your Bible. It'll tell you how to do that. If you ever question whether or not something's in God's will, read the Bible. It'll tell you whether it is or not. Verse 3, Paul shows his personal humility. That's important because Paul, he was able to reach the masses because he kept humble. As pastors, we must keep humble. As Christians, we must be humble when we're presenting God's word, because if we come across as arrogant, if we come across as holier than thou, people will shut their ears off. They'll stop listening. They won't accept what we have to say. So we need to follow Paul's example here where we are humble. And he says, when he is talking to us, he indicates the gift of his apostleship came from unadulterated grace of God. He spoke out of grace. He said, I speak out of grace. And he was attempting to remind us as Christians, we are to exercise sound thinking about ourselves. Not the holier than thou. Just because I'm saved doesn't mean I'm better than those who are not. It means I have a responsibility to help those who aren't to become saved, to introduce them to God. They're not to have an exaggerated opinion of themselves because it's not accurate. Pride has an inflated view of oneself. When you are prideful and you think that you are better than someone else, I keep referring to Bertha Better Than You, who always likes to sit there and judge while they're in church. It's not an actual person. But if it were, she would personify everything that a Christian should not do. We are not to be vain. We are not to think highly of ourselves. Even pastors are not to think highly of themselves. We are not elevated to a position above you. We do have responsibilities when it comes to shepherding you. We do have responsibilities when it comes to make sure that you are being guided. But it does not make us better than you. We are not to think of ourselves as anything more than a part of Christ. A part of the body of Christ. Just because a person has a gift of leadership doesn't mean they're more valuable to the congregation. For those of you thinking, what would be my gift? All you have to do is look at the fruits of the Spirit. Spiritual gifts can be anything that God enhances in your life, that your ability. Some people have the gift of helps. How many people have heard of the gift of helps before? The gift of helps, for those of you not sure what it is, not sure what I'm talking about, the gift of helps is the person who has a spiritual gift to help someone in need. The gift of helps tends to work behind the scenes and get things done. The individual who has the gift of helps will often do his or her own job as well as help others do their job. They're not searching for more responsibility, but they are absolutely willing to help shoulder the responsibility of others because they are blessed with the gift to help others. They have personality that is humble, and they have no problem sacrificing time and energy to do God's work. That is someone who has the gift of helps. In 1 Corinthians, it says, now you are the body of Christ and members individually, and God has appointed these to the church. First, apostles. We read from the apostles. We know who the apostles are. We've read about them. Then it says, second, prophets. We've also read about the prophets. We know of the prophets. We read their information. We read what's in the Bible. Third, teachers. Pastors are teachers. We have teachers that teach Sunday school. After that, miracles. Miracles are something that only God can do in a church. Miracles are performed by God only. The gift of healing, again, something that God has the power to do within a church and within an individual. That is something that He does for the members of the church. Then there is the gift of helps, which I just went over. Administration. It's very important if somebody has the gift of administration that they help out, because someone like me who's not very organized, I can use all the help I can get. Then it says varieties of tongues. Let me be clear about this. Varieties of tongues is not speaking in tongues. It's not saying that we could speak gibberish or baby talk and have somebody 5 days later go, I know what that meant, and I'll tell you what it meant. No. When it says varieties of tongues, it's talking about somebody like Brother Tino. It's talking about people who have the ability to speak multiple languages. Brother Tino is very, very useful to spreading God's word, because not only could he spread God's word in English, but he could share it in Spanish as well, something that I'm not able to do. I'm not blessed with that, but he is blessed with the varieties of tongues. God made each believer unique in the way that he gifted us, and each one of us have a responsibility to use those gifts to further God's will. In verse 4, we're told the church is not a group of individuals doing their own thing. We may be a group of individuals, but when we come together as the church, as the body of Christ, we are both corporate body and individual member. We are individuals that are part of one thing, one entity. And when we do this, we look, and what we do should always be in cooperation for one goal, glorifying God. That's it. Each gift serves a role and does not stand alone apart from any other gifts. We know this. There's corporate function of the church and a communal character. Now, what that means, what it means to have a communal character, is that I've heard so many times talking to people when I ask, well, where do you go to church? Or where have you gone to church? And they'll say, oh, I went to this church over here. But man, I walked in there and they looked at me and they gave me a dirty look. So that church is rude. The thing is that we as an individual, whether we want to understand or believe it or not, we represent the body of Christ. We represent the body of Christ as this church. So our actions speak as a body. So our image that we portray, if one person says, I got a dirty look, so Light of the Valley is rude, that's what we have as a communal image. That's what we are portrayed as, even if it came from one individual. We are all the same body. We play different parts. Just like being justified, people aren't sure sometimes what it means to be in God's will. Usually, when people talk about being in God's will, they refer to decision-making. They'll refer to God's will concerning choosing a wife or a husband, or things like, I wonder if is it in God's will for me to start a new career? Is it in God's will for me to purchase a second car or a new home? Is that in God's will? And then they start looking for signs. The Bible teaches us to store up knowledge and wisdom from God's word. We are to read the Bible, learn from the Bible, and store what we learn inside, not just in our heads, but in our hearts. Because when we do this, we can make wise decisions. Decisions like, this is a bigger decision than I can make on my own. I better seek counsel. Wise counsel of godly people. That would be one decision that we would be able to make. We put our pride aside when we do, because we know that that is what's right. To live close fellowship with God, we can only do through reading our Bible. That's where we discern God's desires for us, and we are able to obey His commands and commandments. If we do these things, the decisions we make, we are able to say without a doubt would be acceptable to God, because we know that our guidance is coming from God, not from our minds, not from other people. It's coming from God. Does that mean that we shouldn't seek God's guidance concerning decision making? No, we absolutely should. We should consult God on things that we aren't sure about. That's why whenever you hear a pastor say, "I've been called to another church, but I really have to pray about it," they're seeking counsel from God. They're looking towards the Bible for an answer to whether or not they truly need to move to that new church that they're being called to. We absolutely need to seek God's guidance, but we don't discern God's will by some eerie experience, by some kind of coincidence. We don't discern God's will by following our feelings, because we know that our feelings don't have anything to do with God's will. We don't rip a verse from the Bible and take it out of context and make it say whatever we want to justify what we want. We don't divine God's wisdom or His will. We read it in the Bible. That is how we know God's will. When we read our Bible and we follow God's will in our lives, in areas where He is clearly commanded through Scripture, then we're able to make decisions with a purer heart that is only produced by God's Word. Now, what I mean by that is there are some examples that God was very specific. He said, "This is my will." Example of that is in Ephesians, where it says, "Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding that the will of the Lord is." Now, we should know what the will of the Lord is so that we're not unwise. There's at least one, if not a couple, who says, "Well, how?" People say, "Well, how am I supposed to do that? How am I supposed to really know what God's will is?" Well, the Bible is filled with everything we need. The Bible is filled with teachings and commands that are acceptable to God's will. People say, "I want to do the Lord's work. I want to be in the will of God. I want to live how God says I should live." So, what do? We go to the Bible. I find that the principles by which I'm supposed to live are in there. God clearly says what we're supposed to be doing in our lives. By reading the Bible, we can know exactly how God would like us to live, what is acceptable in God's will. I go to the Bible to find commandments, or commands, if you will, all the thou shalls and thou shalt nots. And I read them, and then I contemplate what they mean in my life. I think about it, and what they call meditate, not the way that other people meditate, but I think about it, I pray about it. What does it mean in my life? Then I find examples in the Bible, illustrations of those who have actually followed these commandments and those who have not. And I see exactly what happens to each of them. I find out what happens when you do not follow the will of God. Most of the time, it doesn't work out very well for you. The Bible sometimes frustrates people because they say it's not as specific as I would like it to be. You know, I would love it if the Bible was a little more specific. It will not tell you the name of the person you're supposed to marry. That's not going to be written in the Bible. But it will tell you the type of person, what they should be like, what their personality should be, what their beliefs that they hold should be. That should be how you tell whether or not somebody is correct for you to marry. We're not to be unequally yoked, even though my poor wife was unequally yoked for quite a few years. We are not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. The reason for that is because their unbelief could cause us to stumble. It could cause us to second guess ourselves. It could cause us to second guess God. So if my wife had gone by what the Bible says a godly man should be, I wouldn't be married right now. It's only through the grace of God that I am. That doesn't mean that God's not specific about certain things. Jesus told us it was God's will that we should be saved. In John, it says, "And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." Again, Jesus tells us, John 6:40, "And this is the will of him who sent me." That's how he started it. He prefaced it with, "God said so." It's also God's will that we repent and not be condemned to hell. Some people want to twist that around. They want to say, what kind of God would condemn people to hell? What kind of God would give a child AIDS or cancer or any other horrible thing? The answer is, God doesn't give and God does not do that. That's the answer. But it does say it's in God's will that we should not be condemned to hell and that we should repent. 2 Peter 3:9 says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance." Now, not willing. God's not willing to have one of us be condemned to hell. It's God's will that we be sanctified. I said that at the beginning. We covered what sanctified means. In 1 Thessalonians 4:3, it says, "For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that you should abstain from sexual immorality." Now the thing is there, we could take "you should abstain from" and we could put in any sin, because that is what we are looking at. We are not just supposed to abstain from one, because somebody might take that out of context and say, well, as long as I'm away from sexual immorality, I'm good, I'm in God's will. No, we are to abstain from sin itself. Remember, we're not supposed to be of the world. That is the world. The world is sin. Lastly, it is the will of God to give thanks for all things in all situations. Now, this one is one that a lot of people like to wrestle with. They like to wrestle with God over this one because they don't understand it. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." His purpose means God's will. God's will is not a mystery we must solve. It's following what's written in the Bible. It's following the teachings of Jesus. In those times when it was dark and it was hard for Jesus, he prayed to the Lord. We sometimes run into this problem ourselves, especially when it comes to giving thanks. You see, the answer to our question of how are we supposed to give thanks in all situations is in Romans 8:28, where it says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." There will be times that God's will not line up with your wants or your needs. But we must remember that in those times, what Jesus said when he was in prayer in the garden. See, Jesus prayed three times in the garden. And each time, he prayed the same thing. In Matthew 26:39, it tells us what Jesus did. 26:39, it says, "He went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Jesus is showing his humanity there. He's not questioning God, because at the end, he says, not as I will, but you will. In Matthew 26, 42, it says again, a second time, he went away and prayed, saying, Oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me, unless I drink it, your will be done. We must remember that in times where it is difficult for us, we should always be saying, Your will be done, Lord. And then in Matthew 26, 44, it says, So he left them, went away again, he being Jesus, them being the disciples, the apostles, and he prayed a third time, saying the same words. Each time Jesus ended with, Not my will, but yours, Lord. The question I have for everyone today is, are you obeying God? Are you reading the Bible so that you know what God's will is and can be in His will? Have you repented of your sins and have you turned to Christ to save you? If not, that is God's will for you. As followers of Christ, are you rejecting the world's values and being transformed by the Word of God daily? If not, I want to encourage you to start today. For this is God's will for you. It's even your sanctification. God's will is only possible when we live according to His design and His purpose in our lives. It cannot be our will. It can only be God's will. At this time, I'm going to ask Brother Bill to join me. We're going to have a time of reflection and prayer. I want to encourage everyone to pray and ask God to show you where you can better yourselves, to where you can become more like Christ. I want to encourage you to thank God for the blessings of the brave men and women who gave everything, so that we can have the luxury, and it is a luxury, to be able to praise the Lord without fear. Take this time to reflect on everything that God has done in your life, every gift that He has given you. Praise Him for those gifts. Count those blessings, and then make a concerted effort. Decide now to be the time where you go out and you share those gifts. You share those blessings with others, that they may too come to know the love of the Lord. Brother Bill, can you close us in prayer?
Let us pray. Our gracious Father, thank you for this message that you've given, Pastor, for us this day. And help us to just always remember, Father, you gave us this land to be a beacon to the world. Help us keep that light going, Father. The world needs you so much, and we need you here. The need is great. And as your word said, the workers are few. Let us speak when we can, Father, when the opportunity comes along, that we don't hold back, so we can help spread that light. Be with all of us now this week, Lord, as we go out and do our weekly chores. Be with us, keep us safe, that we can come back next week and worship you again in a group. Help us worship you all week, Lord, and keep your word in front of us. In Jesus' name, amen.